Hi, I'm Mark Manster, architecture critic of the Dallas Morning News and author of The Man in the Glass House, and you're listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
It's U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. In our ongoing quest to learn from the best, we've visited other design podcast hosts, such as Francis Anderton, Josh Cooperman, David Lee, and Marina Boudarnay. Today, we welcome the host of the first and longest-running design podcast in America, Debbie Millman of Design Matters. And now, the guy who used to think that the Venice Biennale was an ice cream shop, George Smart.
Howdy, folks. I was at an L.A. party, and someone said they were going to the Venice Biennale. I didn't really know what that was, and I was trying to be supportive, you know, like you do at an L.A. party. I asked her what her favorite flavor was, and, well, the conversation went downhill from there. Turns out, the Venice Biennale is a very well-known design festival held in Venice, Italy, every 2 years, and attended by people from all over the world. However, score 1 point for me. They do serve amazing ice cream, specifically gelato, and it is really very good. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by modernist realtor Angela Roll.
In the Atlantic Ocean near Boston, a fishing boat rescues a raft containing an unconscious woman in a red cocktail dress, a DeWalt toolkit, and an old iPhone 4. Still working, but wiped clean. The woman has no memory, but the ship's doctor finds a tattoo on her ankle with the address of an In-N-Out burger and the words triple-double animal-style Dostoevsky. When the ship docks, she takes her tools and drives across country to the building location in sunny and modernist Palm Springs. Relying on her undergraduate degree in Russian literature, she knew, like we all do at some level, that Fyodor Dostoevsky's profound examinations of the human soul would be the key to finding her identity and make for a satisfying burger as well. To her shock, the In-N-Out burger is boarded up with a sign that WeWork has purchased the property for yet another co-working space with outstanding coffee and no privacy. She grabs a heavy-duty DeWalt impact drill and breaks in. Steel doors fall down behind her. She is trapped. Then the iPhone rings. Will she escape to one day rent scooters on Mykonos? Will she ever attend the Venice Biennale? Tune in next time for episode 2 of The Roll Identity. Meanwhile, memory restored, modernist realtor Angela Roll specializes in modernist houses, advising buyers and sellers on everything from appropriate renovation to whether Pushkin or Chekhov would win a rap battle. Reach her at angelaroll.com. That's R-O-E-H-L or 919-995-0550.
Thanks, Tom.
Oh, you're welcome.
That was a great adventure. Debbie Millman is the founder and host of the pioneering, award-winning, long-running, and successful podcast Design Matters. Going into her 14th year, Debbie has interviewed over 400 designers, artists, and others in the creative culture, such as Milton Glaser, Malcolm Gladwell, Barbara Kruger, Massimo Vignelli, Marina Abramovic, Thomas Kail, Laurie Anderson, and Stephen Heller. She's a polymath of designer, artist, writer, educator, curator, speaker, and CEO. She was the president, design and chief marketing officer at Sterling Brands from 1995 to 2016. And from 2015 to 2017, she was the editorial and creative director of Print Magazine. Her podcast, Design Matters, won the 2011 Cooper Hewitt Design National Award, a Webby for Best Individual Episode, and in 2015, Apple designated one of the best overall podcasts on iTunes.
Wow.
She is the author of 6 books, including How to Think Like a Great Graphic Designer, Brand Thinking and Other Noble Pursuits, and The Brand Bible, King James Edition. She has spoken all over the world, including India, New Zealand, Hong Kong, and New York, among dozens, if not hundreds, of other cities. Her art has been included in the Boston Biennale, which serves great clam chowder, the Chicago Design Museum, Anderson University, and the Chung Institute for Contemporary Art. She writes for the New York Times, New York Magazine, Print Magazine, and Fast Company. And in her spare time, she is the chair of the Masters in Branding program at the School of Visual Arts, a program she co-founded. I think, Tom, this may be our most accomplished guest to date.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out where the spare time comes from.
Yeah. Debbie, welcome.
Thank you. You guys are cracking me up.
So before we get started, since you have a background in Russian literature, who would win a rap battle between Russian writers Pushkin and Chekhov?
I would say Pushkin.
Pushkin.
I would say Pushkin. Yeah, that would be a very, very close call, but I would go with Pushkin.
And how would we know who won if I don't know Russian? Do you?
I know it in English translation.
Oh, I should learn that.
My minor was in Russian literature in English translation. And given that my major was in English literature, I often now joke that I have a college degree in reading.
Yeah, which is how you got to where you are.
Yes.
So does design matter?
Oh, yes. It matters way beyond, I think, most people realize.
Well, let's explore that a little bit. I'd like to know how design found you. Where did you grow up and when did design become a thing for you?
I am a native New Yorker, which is where I still live today. I was born in Brooklyn, New York, lived there for the first 2 years of my life, then was moved with my family to Howard Beach, Queens, where I lived until about the middle of third grade. And then we moved after my dad bought his own pharmacy to Staten Island and lived there until the end of fifth grade, when my parents had a very acrimonious divorce and my mom took my brother and I to Long Island, where I was a resident until I went off to college and went to the State University of New York to get my degree in reading. And then while I was there, I fell in love with the student newspaper, and it took me quite a number of years before they would give me anything to work on until the end of my junior year, to be more accurate. But by the beginning of my senior year, I was appointed the arts and features editor of the student newspaper, and that is where I fell in love with design. I was very quickly struck by the realization that I was much more interested in how the paper actually was put together than the specific content of the articles. Although I was fascinated by that as well, I was obsessed with how the paper was put together and then quite by accident discovered this discipline called design. Given that my major and minor were in utterly useless marketable skills, I only had the skills that I had learned at the student newspaper to help me get a job when I graduated. And I very quickly came back to Manhattan, found a job working for a cable magazine. And in 1983, cable was all the rage.
Oh, yeah.
I remember.
So it was quite an interesting job. And thus began my entry into the discipline of design and graphics and branding and what I still actually do today.
I bet you were into fonts, weren't you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We had three fonts back at SUNY Albany at that time. We had Gaudi, we had Souvenir, and we had a very 70s-looking typeface called Peignot, P-E-I-G-N-O-T. And that might be familiar to some people because it is the font that's used in the opening graphics of the Mary Tyler Moore Show.
Oh, yeah.
Is it kind of blocky? Oh, that's right. Oh.
And so, yes, I was smitten and then very quickly became really immersed in all things graphic design.
At that time, you were working where?
I was working at a cable magazine called Cableview.
Was it like a TV guide?
It was like a TV guide with a bit more heft. It was more of a standard size magazine as opposed to sort of pocket size.
Okay.
And it was four color and it had quite a lot of editorial content. And my initial job there was sort of the traffic girl. I was the person who was running interference between the editorial department and the art department. So I actually got quite a lot of experience in both areas, which has helped my career ever since, really.
How long were you there?
I was there a year, and then I really made a very bad decision. I was so broke at that time that I took a job that offered me quite a bit more money, about 50% more money, but it wasn't anywhere near as interesting or creative. And I did that for a year. At that time, people were telling you that you really couldn't do anything for less than a year, otherwise it would look bad on your resume.
Yeah, I remember
so
that.
So I stayed for a year and cried every single day.
Oh.
Yeah, it was a tough one.
Then what happened?
Then I decided to beg my then employer to fire me so that I could collect unemployment and try to figure out what I would do with the rest of my life, which they mercifully agreed to do. And then I started freelancing and I started working at a rock and roll magazine called Rockville, freelancing, and then finally did get a full-time job there and was able to then, a couple of years into that experience, the creative director and I left and started our own design business, but not before I had been offered the editor-in-chief job of Rockville. And Rockville was sort of like Playbill, but given out at rock venues and concert venues.
I remember Rockville. I worked in rock radio back then.
And,
yeah, I probably got handed a few copies of it, and I'm sure I admired the design.
Oh, well, thank you. I was also doing some editorial work, which I loved. But what happened was the editor-in-chief, who was a dear friend of mine and is still a dear friend of mine to this day, all these years later, 30-something years later, he was having all sorts of issues with the then publisher, and he decided that he was going to quit in defiance to this publisher. But before he did that, he offered me his job as editor-in-chief. I was the managing editor. But I felt that it would be disloyal to take a job that my friend was leaving for political reasons, that what would be the impact of his departure if I just stepped into the role. And so even though I wanted the job really badly, I turned it down. And then he asked the guy that was second in command if he wanted it. And this guy said yes. And so leapfrogged me to become the editor in chief. And I was humiliated and ultimately left with one of my other friends that worked there. And we started our own design firm and had that for about 5 years before I left and entered the world of branding.
Now, I know that you've written several times that you had a life crisis at 30.
Yeah, that was part of
it. Was that part of that movement into branding?
Well, it was a life crisis in that in the early 90s, and I turned 30 in 91, in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, it was a very special moment in the world of design. People like Tibor Kalman had come into the big leagues big time, became very, very famous for doing really provocative work. Bill Drentel and Stephen Doyle had started Drentel Doyle. Emily Oberman and Bonnie Siegler started Number 17. Double Space had created some of the great graphics of the time. Manhattan Design did the MTV logo. I mean, it was just a really big moment in graphic design in New York City. And I felt that my work was really quite shabby in comparison. But even more importantly, I didn't know how I could ever be great at doing graphic design. I didn't really have any training. You know, I learned on the job at my school newspaper and then in the sort of real world, and had never been privy to how really great work was made. And so I had a crisis of confidence. I had a crisis of purpose. I was getting divorced. So I was having a crisis of love, in love.
You were a mess.
I was a mess.
For a little while.
Did you go back to Dostoevsky at this point and look for advice?
No, I went to therapy.
Oh, therapy. Okay.
And I turned back into a lot of the things, I turned back towards a lot of the things that I was really passionate about at that time in my life and still to this day, and creating a lot of my own self-generated work. I was painting, I was writing, you know, I was trying to figure myself out. But it was an important time, as difficult as it was. It helped me take a stand for what I really did want, the kind of life I ultimately wanted to create for myself. And though it took a long time, was able to do that.
And looking back now at that time, was your self-criticism warranted?
I think anybody that knows me well will tell you that I'm hard on myself, but I have really high expectations of what I'd like to be able to do with my life. And so I've always been really critical of my own intentions and efforts and ambitions and my ability to do things that have meaning.
So you're the one in the background with that little voice on both shoulders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would say
your own angel and devil.
Yeah, right. Just chattering away at you.
Yeah, definitely.
Which must have been good fodder for the therapist.
And still is.
There you go. Now, I also read some of your writing about going to therapy. I thought that was really interesting. You gave some great advice on how to be a good therapy client.
Oh, yeah. I think I is that in Tim Ferriss's book?
I think it was mentioned. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Tim has just been such an incredible support and friend to me. And he was the person who actually asked me to expound upon that in his book, Tribe of Mentors, because he had asked a question that I guess somewhat whimsically answered, which I think he asked, what was your greatest investment? And I wrote back and said, therapy. And then he asked me to expound upon that. And then I took it really seriously because I do feel that it profoundly, profoundly, not only changed my life and influenced the way that I lived, but also saved my life in a lot of ways.
What was the turning point for you in terms of when therapy really took hold and you could see some insights about it?
I think it was really a moment where I was committed, where I became committed to it. A very, very dear friend of mine, and this is the early 90s, going back to the early 90s, one of the biggest crises of our times was AIDS. I mean, it still is globally. But at the time, I had a very, very dear friend that was dying, who ultimately did die. And watching him struggle to live. He wanted so badly to live. He wanted so badly to have his whole life. And I was struggling every single day to figure out what my life meant, if I was worthy of even being alive. And when I saw how much he wanted to be alive, compared with how hard it was for me to stay alive, I knew I had to take my own journey and my own mental health really, really seriously.
You really had to become a coach for yourself.
I guess so. I don't know that I would necessarily put it that way. I think I had to allow somebody else to coach me.
Yeah, I get through learning about you, though, that you're very driven and very organized in your drive.
I am very organized. I am. I've actually been told that very recently. I have a new partner in my life, and she has been looking at my apartment, my house, and has been astounded at how well organized I am.
Oh, that's great.
I take great pride in my closet.
You don't need a visit from Marie Kondo, then.
No, actually, I think that part of my organization now is encouraged by my interest in Marie Kondo and the cultural sort of fascination people have with that, because I have been and will continue to be somebody who only likes to have things around me that, I mean, I wouldn't have thought of it as sparking joy in the way mm-hmm. that I do now, but I would have said made me happy.
Yeah, we are in such a hoarding culture.
We are. And as somebody who is a huge, huge mid-century modern enthusiast, that doesn't really go well with hoarding.
No, you have to really choose one or the other.
Exactly.
You can't be a cluttered modernist, really.
No.
That's
and
a
I
pretty
get,
rare
I get
brand.
Real joy out of getting rid of things.
What are some of the things that you have in your apartment? What have you elected strategically to stay with you as part of the joyful production?
Well, one thing, what's interesting is that I moved to a new home 3.5 years ago. And in my previous home, I had furniture that was very specific to that space. I had a beautiful circular couch that I had that was found in an antique shop and then refinished, remade and refinished for the space that I have. And so when I moved, none of that really translated into my new space, which is quite different. I went from living in a duplex to living in a house that has a parlor room, and that's sort of where the living room is. That's sort of the big great room. And so really none of my living room furniture was able to translate into this new space. And so I needed to really acquire new things. And I decided that I wanted things that would last forever. And so I spent a lot of time. In fact, I spent about 3 years waiting until I felt that the furniture that I was picking was the right furniture for this space.
What did you have furnishing your house before that? I mean, that's 3 years is a long time.
I had some hodgepodge furniture. I had some wonderful Eames chairs that had worked really well in the previous living room, but it really looked like the living room of wayward furniture. I had some beautiful furniture. It just wasn't really. I had the Mies lounge. I had some wonderful Eames chairs, but nothing really worked together, and it wasn't meant to. And so I just had whatever I still had from my old place that could work to some degree in my new space. So the two things that I acquired from my new space, which I've only gotten in the last year, are the Tiho Rami Droog drawers, the chest of drawers that Tiho Rami did for Droog, which is now actually featured in a wonderful segment in the Dieter Rams documentary that Gary Hustwit did as the one piece of furniture that Dieter Rams feels is a complete mistake and should never have been made.
Kind of like Waterworld for Kevin Costner.
Exactly. And then the other piece that I have is the Eve Klein table. It with the Eve Klein blue powder in it. And so those are really two of the big centerpieces now of my living room.
You're 30 years old. You've survived a divorce. You've gone into successful therapy. You have changed the arc of your career. What happens next?
Well, so I'm at that point in my early 30s. And I get a job at a company called Sterling Brands. And Sterling Brands was hiring me as a salesperson. So I had gone from working as a designer through the 80s and then getting a job as an account executive at a very well-respected, renowned design firm. That firm would not hire me as a designer. They didn't think I was good enough. They hired me as an account executive, but that job was not what I would consider to be success in terms of my doing well there. It was not a good fit. The boss, the head partner didn't like me very much. And I always tell people now, never, ever go get a job or take a job with somebody that you feel doesn't like you, because it never gets better. There's never a point at which that person that didn't like you to begin with has a complete change of heart and suddenly is willing to mentor you.
It's so also good advice for marriages.
You know, yeah, that's probably true,
and
too.
It seems so obvious, but you may think, I can win them over. I can do it. And you kill yourself trying to do it. That's great advice.
So I ended up quite out of desperation taking a job as a salesperson in a branding agency. And because of my background, having worked and been exposed to so many brands from a very young age and working in my dad's pharmacy, I took to branding almost as if I were meant to work in that field. I had a sensibility about branding that felt innate. I had extremely good instincts. I was an excellent salesperson. So while the job I took was really one out of desperation because I needed to be able to pay my mortgage, it quickly was something I realized I really enjoyed, I understood intrinsically, and was quite good at. And that really began my career at Sterling Brands. So I started there in 95. By 98, I became a partner, became president of the agency. By 2008, so about 13 years later, my two partners and I, we were able to successfully sell the company to Omnicom. And so that was quite an extraordinarily stroke of good luck for me. And I continued working there for another 8 years. So altogether, I worked there over 20. I loved being on a more global stage, being a part of Omnicom. I became one of the members of the governing body of an organization within Omnicom called Omni Women, which was an organization started by Janet Riccio, who created the opportunity for very senior women to come together to be able to work and mentor each other and support our individual and collective efforts. And that was life-changing. And so I really enjoyed it. Finally, by 2016, I felt like I needed to go out on my own again, that I had so many different things that I wanted to work on, that it really wasn't possible anymore to have several full-time jobs. I was working full-time at Sterling. I had started my department at my graduate department at the School of Visual Arts, which I still run now. And I had this podcast that I had been sort of doing for quite a long time, even at that point.
Well, tell me about the podcast. How did that get started? Because that's what is fascinating us, being in this just a couple of years now, but you've been doing it almost 14.
Yes. February 4th will be 14 years, which seems ridiculous. I started it again, quite by accident. At that point, I started in 2005. The end of 2004. I had been at Sterling for 10 years. I had all but made the full transition from design to branding. Everything that I was doing at that point was quite global in nature. Decisions were made not just on aesthetics, but on market share and a return on an investment. And everything that I was doing was quite commercial. And I loved it, but I missed some of what I'd been doing in the previous 10 years of my career, which was more design oriented, which was more craft oriented. And I had been cold called by a fledgling internet radio network called Voice America.
Oh, yeah. I remember.
Offering me what I thought was a job, but it really was an opportunity. They were actually pitching me to pay them to produce this radio show for me. And at the time, I really was, because I had spent so much time in the first 10 years of my career desperate for success. When I finally was successful at something, I gave everything else up in an effort to really capitalize on that success. And I stopped doing any of my personal or self-generated work. And I missed it. I felt like I was losing a big part of myself after 10 years of not doing it. And so when this opportunity came along to do the radio show, I thought, well, this might be a good sort of way to bridge my personal interests with my career, because I could do something that would include maybe some of my clients or some of the brands that I want to work with and talk about how they were created. Voice America really wanted me to do it on branding, but I was, and again, because I was paying them, I think there was a little bit more wiggle room to do something that I wanted. And so when I pitched them the idea of doing Design Matters with the proviso that I include branding in that, they gave me the green light. But again, I had to pay them. And if you listen to my early shows, it almost feels like Wayne and Garth from Wayne's World are producing
show. Wayne's World.
Yeah.
Exactly. In their basement. Was their pitch to you originally as a radio show?
It was a radio show. They weren't podcasts, or there was a handful of podcasts that was by no means a cultural phenomenon at that point. I started to upload my shows on iTunes quite by accident, in that friends of mine wanted to listen to the show, but it was a live radio show. And so I couldn't send them someplace to listen to the show.
It was
broadcast once during the week, but you know, it's a bizarre midnight hour. And so in an effort to be able to give my friends more of an opportunity to listen to the show, I started uploading the digital files to iTunes. But
there was no podcast app at the time.
No, God, action. Yeah. I mean, it was almost like I was an indie musician. By October of that year, I started uploading my shows I think, in April. And then by October, there was a podcast section. And I remember at the time, I was, I think, number 85 in the podcast charts. But I think there were like 100 podcasts. So it really wasn't saying a lot.
Yeah, what a great time to be starting a show when there are only 100 podcasts available. And now I think there are like 250,000 or something.
I think there might even be more than that. But yeah, there are a lot of podcasts. I mean, I really feel quite lucky in the way that that unfurled, because there was no, people ask me all the time, how did you know podcasting was going to get so big? I'm like, oh, I had no idea. I was just desperate to do something creative. And this was a way that
you got to work on your narrative there. You know, I knew it from the start. I knew it in 1987.
It came to me in therapy.
Right.
Right.
You've had some great guests on the show. We mentioned some of those at the top. Malcolm Gladwell, Barbara Kruger, Laurie Anderson. I was trying to find, have you had some architects on the show?
Oh, yes. I've had Michael Arad, who designed the 9/11 memorial. I've done quite a lot of work with different architecture organizations that have festivals. So the Texas Architects Society, I've emceed their conference, the AIA conference in, I don't remember what city it was in. I think it was in San Antonio. But I've done quite a lot of work with architects and really have begun to do more and more and more, because a lot of architects now are writing to me about being on the show. And so when I do my research and discover their work, I get really excited.
Over time, how has the podcast evolved for you?
Well, the show really began as a lighthearted conversation that I would have with other designers, hence the name Design Matters. It was really designers talking to designers, very inside baseball. Over the years, as I've become a better interviewer and as my interests have expanded, the show has become a show about how incredibly creative people design the arc of their lives. I'm really endlessly fascinated by how people become who they are. And so I feel that it is a way for me to try to unlock some of the mystery in the, I said mystery and my phone thought I was saying Siri. Because I'm much more interested in talking to all different types of creative people. And that could be musicians, performers, writers, artists, poets. I'm really interested in how incredibly creative people are able to craft an incredibly creative life. What is it about these people that allow them to believe in their work so much that they are committed to making a life with that work? And because I didn't have that, I am endlessly fascinated on how people are able to do it.
Are you so sure about that? Because you, sir, seem to have it by all these accomplishments.
Yeah, but it's, I'm 57 years old. I didn't have this when I was 25. I didn't have this when I was 35. I didn't start Design Matters until I was well into my 40s. So it's taken me quite a long time. And I still am really, really interested in how people make it happen for themselves. And so I can't imagine ever being tired by this quest.
Are you a fan of Fake It Till You Make It?
I'm a fan of Amy Cuddy. Very much. I'm not a fan of what I say to my students, because I always show them her power pose video, which I think is really good. What I say is make it till you make it.
Just keep going.
Yeah, because you're not faking it when you're attempting. Just make it until you make it.
Persistence and determination.
Yeah. And because I also feel like I'm happiest when I'm making things. And so there's that wonderful double entendre of making something. And so make it till you make it.
And also, you're big on planning. I understand you sneaked your way into a Milton Glaser lecture.
I didn't sneak my way in. I applied and got in, but the sneaky part of it was that I was then a writer for print magazine, and I would get, as a writer, advanced issues. And there was an ad in the issue about this special intensive Milton Glaser class that was being offered that summer, that following summer. And I had gotten my issue, I think it was like a winter issue, January or so. And because I got it early, I was one of the first to apply, and it was first come, first serve. So I wouldn't say it was sneaky. I would say that it was, well, maybe there was some nepotism involved.
Yeah, a little insider trading, but that's okay.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
The SEC is not going to come after you for that one.
Right. And so, yes, I did take Milton's class, and that's where I was first exposed to what he had as a 5-year plan. So to envision your life 5 years out, it was for mid-career designers. So I can understand why he wanted to make it 5 years. When I teach the exercise now, because my students are primarily younger designers or branding students, I give them 10 years. So they have a bit more runway. It also took me 12 years to pretty much get everything on my 5-year plan list. So I wanted to be a bit more realistic. You know, Milton is a genius polymath, so it might have been a bit easier for him to get what he wanted within 5 years.
But still, getting something done, getting a list like that done in 12 years is still fantastic, because a lot of people don't get it done at all.
Well, I think part of taking this exercise seriously is the declaration of what it is you want, is this very clear understanding that this is what you want to make with your life.
I understand that we have some mutual friends, Jake and Tracy Gorst.
Yes, Leisurama. Mm-hmm. I love Jake Gorst. He's mm-hmm. wonderful.
Yeah, I run into him all the time out in Palm Springs. And in association with various documentaries, we've had him as a guest on the show.
Wonderful. He's brilliant. And his wife is divine.
They have really put out a number of well-done documentaries.
Yes, they have.
You have been involved in a couple of really interesting organizations I don't think the public nationally is familiar with, as are people in New York. And that is the Joyful Heart Foundation and the No More organization. Can you tell us about those?
Well, I started working with the No More organization through a very, very dear friend of mine who was at that point a client. A friend of mine, a woman named Christine Mao, and at the time she was the global design director of Kimberly Clark, the makers of Kleenex and Scott and Viva and Cottonelle. And I was doing a lot of work with her on the redesign and repositioning of a lot of those brands. And she asked me if I would be interested in working with her, if Sterling would be interested in working with her pro bono to help launch the No More Foundation. And the No More Foundation was a consortium of organizations, including Kimberly Clark, that were coming together to help amplify the messages of a number of other organizations that were committed to eradicating sexual assault, domestic violence, and child abuse. And she was doing this with Kimberly Clark, but also was looking for various partners to collaborate. And so she asked if Sterling would be interested. And I spoke to my partners, and we were absolutely positively interested. And so Christine and I and a group of really committed people at Sterling created the positioning and the identity for No More. One of the organizations that is part of No More is an organization called the Joyful Heart Foundation. And the Joyful Heart Foundation was founded by the actress and activist Mariska Hargitay. She is the star of Law & Order SVU, which has been on TV now for 20 years.
Oh, just forever. It's the longest running series now, isn't it? I think it's a drama.
It's right now with Gunsmoke, but I think it was one more year.
It will beat Gunsmoke.
Yes, which I think it will do. It's doing really well. Still 20 years in. So in any case, when Mariska started on the show, she started to get a lot of letters from victims of sexual assault, domestic violence, and child abuse. The show is Law and Order SVU, which is, SVU stands for Special Victims Unit, which is about people that are the victims of these heinous, as they say on the show.
Heinous crimes.
Right. Heinous crimes. Boom, boom. And so because I was doing the work with No More, I became aware of the work that Joyful Heart was doing. And I met Mariska and the then CEO, a woman named Miley Zambuto, and they asked me if I'd be interested in helping them as well. And so I started to do work with Miley and Mariska. I helped reposition the organization, created their identity with my graduate students here at the School of Visual Arts. And as soon as that work was finished, they asked me to join the board of directors for Joyful Heart, which I did. And then back in October of 2018, so just a few months ago, I was asked to be the chairman of the board. And so now I'm working very, very closely with Mariska and the team, the extraordinary team and staff of the Joyful Heart Foundation, which is some of the most, if not the most important work of my life.
I looked up the organization. It does a lot of great things. One of the things it tries to do is to get a lot of law enforcement's unprocessed sexual assault kits off the shelves.
Yes.
And tell us about that, because that I think that's fascinating. And
we're very committed to ending the rape kit backlog. Believe it or not, there are hundreds of thousands of unprocessed rape kits.
Oh my goodness.
All over.
Yeah, it's incredible.
For anybody that is interested in this topic, Mariska created a documentary that debuted last year on HBO. It's called I Am Evidence. And it is about the epidemic of rape kits that have gone unexamined, unchecked.
Or thrown away in the case of Fayetteville, North Carolina.
Sitting in warehouses, becoming contaminated. Kim Worthy, who's a prosecutor in Detroit, and Mariska work together. Kim is now on the board of the Joyful Heart Foundation as well, and made this extraordinary documentary that outlines and reveals the massive amount of rape kits that have not been examined. And this is evidence that could keep other perpetrators off the streets.
Because many of the times these are serial incidents.
Yes, they're connected. Most rapes are not one-offs.
Right.
Most rapes are not one-offs. They are perpetrated by serial rapists that do this time and time again, over and over again. And so the documentary outlines and showcases a number of kits that once they were examined, once they were used as evidence, were able to get perpetrators off the street, serial rapists put in jail.
We've got, I think, about 15,000 unprocessed kits in North Carolina at the moment.
Yep.
Wow.
They're working to get the legislature to pay for about half of them and hoping to get private funding for the rest. But this has been an issue that's been around for years and years and years. These have been stacking up. And what's so shameful about it is because they aren't one-offs, there is this connection between one kit to the next, to this incident, to that incident. You can solve a whole bunch of different crimes through just a couple of kits being tested.
Well, the sheer presence of them on the shelves tells you that there's a problem that has not been solved.
Oh, yeah. No, it's an epidemic. It's an epidemic. And it reflects a lot about how women's health, women's sexuality, how rape is perceived. I mean, the condition of these rape kits reflect the condition of our culture in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me ask you a cultural branding question.
Sure.
So architects, with some exceptions, are not necessarily good at branding and promotion. Let's say that a firm comes to you and wants a rebranding because they've been through a little choppy waters. And that firm would be Richard Meier and Partners.
Well, it depends on what Mr. Myers is saying about the allegations. Most people do not make allegations that aren't true. If there are multiple allegations, I would suspect that they are, but I'm in no position to do that empirically because I don't know all of the details. What is his response to this?
His response has been that it was exaggerated or consensual or didn't happen, and he has essentially resigned from the firm. So I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I'm trying to think, let's say for this question that Mr. Meyer's gone and you have the firm that's left still named after him that wants to try to go on.
Yeah. I mean, why would they want to continue with the legacy of his name if he's behaved poorly and...
Oh, no, not that they want to. I'm just saying he's left. They've still got his name. They're coming to you saying,
"So
we want to rebrand now."
A name change might be at the top of her list.
Yeah.
Yeah, a name change would be at the top. I mean, I would be a little bit skeptical and I would ask them some really hard questions. You know, did you know about this? Did you condone this behavior? What was the culture of the organization that allowed this to go on for as long as it has? I have lost my patience with people that are not willing to be accountable for their behavior. And they benefited for a really long time on his coattails, probably are all quite wealthy, although I have no way of knowing that. I think we're in a time of reckoning. I don't know that you can rebrand something that has been damaged in the way that it has. If they still want to ride the coattails of his success, then I think they're going to have a lot of issues.
Well, for example, just sort of on a basic practical level, it seems like if you were running the firm that Richard Meyer used to inhabit, you'd want to rename it, but you'd also want to somehow make those changes like you suggested that atone in some way for this behavior or this culture. How do you help as a brand strategist, a company, start to address that?
Well, I would recommend that their new CEO be a woman.
Okay.
That is deserving of the job. It's not just a token. I would look at doing a widespread cultural reconnaissance to understand what the atmosphere is like in the firm. And I would have a statement that was made very public and very clear about what is and isn't going to be the culture of the company moving forward. And I would be very outspoken about that. The only way rebranding works is if what you're rebranding has a significant value. If you're rebranding to cover up bad behavior, consumers and an audience and the public are much smarter than that, and they can see through it. You're just being opportunistic. If you're rebranding because you're putting a line in the sand and saying, that was then, this is now, and this is what's different about what we're doing now versus then, there's a real purpose to that rebrand. The only way that a rebranding should be done is when it is in tandem with some type of beneficial change to your audience.
Well, on a lighter note, I also read that you, when you're happy, you start singing, like little songs.
Right? Make up songs. I do. I hum a lot.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite little ditty you could do for us?
Well, if you must know, I do have a particular favorite. I have two cats, and they're quite opposite in character, and I feed them a brand called Fancy Feast.
Oh, yes, Fancy Feast.
And so when I'm feeding them, sometimes I've been known to break into a song that goes a little bit something like this. Who wants it fancy? Who wants it feasty? Who wants it fancy? Who wants it feasty? Fancy, feasty, feasty, fancy. Now it is time to eat. I'll stop there.
And the cats go crazy, I guess. They love this.
They do.
I guess they don't just look at you with a blank stare saying, I don't know.
No, they fight over who's fancy and who's feasty.
Okay.
I think they say to themselves, the singing woman gives us food again.
That's right. Right, I think. If she's singing, something's good in the dish.
But we'll put up with it because she feeds us.
It struck a chord with me because when I'm really super happy, there's a little ditty from McHale's Navy early 60s TV show that comes back into my head where they're all singing on the, what kind of ship were they on?
A PT Cruiser.
I think.
Yeah.
It was from the Ernest Borgnine and Tim Conway. But they go, mow, 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 mow. You get the idea. So
I think you all are big fans of anything musical. Kind of love that. Yeah. Yes.
Well, this has been really great. Thank you so much for spending time with us, Debbie.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on your wonderful show.
And we are in your awe for being the Meryl Streep of Design Podcast.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. You guys are too kind. Thank you.
Thanks for listening. U.S. Marnish Radio is underwritten by Angela Roll, your special agent for Marnish Houses, 919-995-0550. Okay, take us out, Tom.
Visit usmodernist.org's massive archives to listen to past shows. Discover records and photos of 7,000 modernist houses by nearly all the most well-known mid-century architects and access 2.5 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song is performed by George Smart and Robinson Earle. Chief of Guest Research Cindy Stratton, not her real name, is back on the job fresh from training at Langley and Tim's house. U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. I'm Tom Guild. George and I'll be back soon with another creatively inspired, culturally sensitive, fancy, feasty edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.